Awesome. Well, thank you again so much, Chris, for being here. I know it's taken a couple attempts and that's mostly my issue, but we're here today now. And I was just wondering if you would introduce yourself for us.
Sure. I'm Christine Ruffcar. I go by Chris, and I'm 52-year-old and never been happier because I'm in recovery from both alcohol addiction and from food and sugar addiction. And I, by day, I'm a data analyst, and by the rest of the time, I'm a dog sitter.
Wow, that's quite the contrast, like data analyst, dog sitter. Like, which one do you enjoy more? Or do you like them both the same?
Well, definitely the dog sitting, but I do really love my job because I work with really great people. But the dog sitting is the kind of thing I would do if I won that $1.5 billion Powerball that's going
right,
on.
If money right wasn't now. An issue, absolutely. Right. Absolutely. I'm with you. So I'm curious to know, would you tell us your story? It sounds like there's a bit of alcohol recovery and there's some food stuff going on. Will you just kind of share with us what life was like before you today?
Oh yeah. So, like a lot of people, you know, my childhood, there was abuse, but not nearly as bad as some people. So I consider myself lucky when I hear some of the stories of recovery, but it, you know, led to trauma and depression and anxiety. And, I was born in 1970, so getting therapy wasn't a thing back in the 70s and 80s. So I was really always looking to deal with my emotions with, you know, food. And then when I turned 18, it was alcohol. But I was always, you know, a healthy weight and really involved in sports. So the food issues and, you know, until I was 18, I wasn't drinking, things were fine, but it was, when I think back about childhood, it's not like a happy time. It's not horrible, but it's not like the happy memories, like a lot of people. So that set me up to be addictive about things, to deal with stuff. So when I graduated college, I had all this money now, and I could go out to eat whenever I wanted. I could eat a lot of food, and I started doing that, and I kept gaining weight. And I, you know, got to a point where I think, you know, the largest I've been was 240 pounds, and I don't feel healthy or good or anything at that weight. But the more important part of it was the obsession with food. I was constantly thinking about, where am I going to eat next? And what if I go to this thing, is there going to be the kind of food I like? And it took up so much emotional energy, and it took away from my ability to interact and build meaningful relationships. And I just really had a really, what I kind of call a small, kind of sad life until I was about 48. And that's when I got sober from alcohol. And when I learned about the 12 steps and that obsession of the mind that they talk about in the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous, I realized I'm doing the same thing with food. And so during the pandemic, I checked out FA, which is Food Addicts in Recovery Anonymous. And it just clicked. And I always say that AA saved my life and FA gave me a life. And the difference between, you know, those first 48 years and the last 4 years is just night and day. I just absolutely love life. Never imagined that life could be this good. I would have been happy just to stop drinking and not develop cirrhosis on the liver and end up being, you know, at an even higher weight. But now it's just amazing how great everything is going. And I'm still very much working on my food addiction. I've conquered the desserts and sweets, and now I'm working on getting rid of refined carbs, white flour type things.
That's so amazing so often we actually hear this story. It's funny, like, that we start with the obvious one, right? Like, alcohol has severe consequences pretty quickly. Mm-hmm. We're like, the food, you know, it catches up with us eventually, but it's like you had this experience in AA and then realized, oh, hey, this is also happening with the food. And I just think that's so amazing. Mm-hmm. Like, you put that together and you started to take steps to rectify that or to change it in some way. And I'm just wondering, so it started back at the beginning of the pandemic. So roughly two and a half years ago, you start this food journey. What was it like in the beginning? Was it anything like your AA journey? Was it completely different. Can you kind of talk to us a bit about like what you experienced early days?
Sure. Well, it was a lot like AA and still is, in that it took me like about 12 years from the first time I went to AA until I really got sober, because I kept thinking, I don't have that big of a problem. I'm blowing this out of proportion. And it's so extreme to never drink alcohol again. And right now I'm thinking, you know, I don't have that big of a problem with food. I'm blowing it out of proportion. It's so extreme to have a food plan like they suggest in the different 12-step food addiction programs. I'm like, but this time around, I know I'm doing that and I'm being gentle and kind with myself. But I know that once I stick to the food plan and I don't keep relapsing, my life is great now. I can't even imagine how much better it's going to be when I can stick to the food plan, get that sense of spirituality and have that food neutrality. So, and I will say, yes, in the very beginning, when I first started going to FA, I thought there is no way in the world I could do a food plan like this. I mean, this is like climbing Mount Everest. I really felt that way. But then I did it. I didn't make it 90 days. Like, you know, that's always kind of a goal that's out there, and I've relapsed a lot, but it is absolutely doable. And I always feel so much better when I'm doing the food plan. I just have some hurdles to get over to get to that, to make it my life food plan.
Yeah. So what was it about, you know, like you said, that it was kind of like, okay, you found FA, and I'm mm-hmm. not sure like how you came to mm-hmm. that program, because I know there's many 12-step mm-hmm. food programs. So what made you choose that program, and what was it specifically about the food plan that had you a bit nervous? Was it the amount of food, the foods that they asked you not to eat, the weighted and measured part? Like, can you kind of walk us through mm-hmm. like what drew you to FA, and then what was it about the food plan that was maybe a bit scary in the beginning?
Sure. Well, so I was in an AA meeting, and I heard someone, or I talked to someone about, I don't know how we mentioned it, but she mentioned how sugar was such an addictive substance, and it's even worse than alcohol. And she mentioned she was either an FA or she was an FAA. I'm not sure, but I just knew after talking to her that there was something out there for food addicts, that was a real thing. And so I didn't look it up right away, but then when the pandemic hit and people were finally using, you know, online meetings, I'm like, oh, I'm going to check out that food addiction thing. And that was the first one I found. So for full transparency, at the moment, I'm not actively involved in FA, but I really want to go back to it. But yeah, as far as the food plan, what just made me consider it like Mount Everest is just, I can be really just lazy about doing things. I don't have kids of my own. So like, I can just come home from work and sit down and watch TV and do nothing. And it's okay. So having to fix food for myself and weigh and measure it, that just seemed unsurmountable. Now I know it's no big deal. I was making it out to be this big, huge thing. The amounts weren't a problem. I was never hungry. In fact, it was sometimes hard to finish all the food. And a lot of that, I think, is with my age. When you get older, my mom was the same way. Her appetite started to decrease, and mine has. So that part wasn't bad. I also really like healthy food. So for me, that wasn't a problem. It's the work. And then, you know, weighing and measuring, I'm like, why does it exactly have to be 4 ounces? If it's 4.2, is it that big of a deal? But I know, I do totally understand why it needs to be 4 ounces. So yeah, those were the things. It was the work involved in it.
Which I think is so relatable. I think many of us mm-hmm. were looking for, I guess, what diet culture has sold us for all these years, right? Like, I have this magic pill, mm-hmm. literally, or this magic weight loss program, just eat the food exactly as I've described it to you and work out this many times and you'll lose mm-hmm. 30 pounds in 30 days. Like, how many times are we standing at the supermarket, like checkout line, and we see the headlines, like, yeah. Right. And so I think it's so relatable that, like you said, it could feel like, Mount Everest. How am I ever going to climb this mountain, for sure? So you had mentioned, you know, like life beforehand was drastically different than it has been the last 4 years. So since entering alcohol recovery and now food recovery and doing this work, you know, what is life like now? Can you kind of describe to us the compare and contrast? What comes to mind when you make that kind of statement?
Oh yeah. I mean, some of the really fun things are like, I can't even find text conversations in my text messages because I have so many friends now and they're meaningful friendships. It's not just some, you know, random person texting me something. And I used to, before I used to think this is so sad. I only have like one or two people that I text with and, you know, one is my boyfriend. So I had shut everyone out because food and drinking were more important. I just wanted to go home and drink wine each night. And now I have people to do stuff with. I actually have too many plans on the weekends to do fun, healthy things like go hiking or go to a trivia night to support a sober living house, you know, things like that. And I have a group of women friends. Every Monday night, we go to a meeting, AA meeting, and then we go out to eat. And we just, I know I could call any one of them if I was having a bad day, and they even understand my food addiction and they could help me with that. Not the same way someone in the program could, in the FA program could, but they get it. So that's a big part of it. If anyone that's involved in the 12 steps, they're familiar with the promises, all of that has come true, especially this is another perfect example. This is a funny one. There's a, step about being able to handle situations which used to baffle us and not know what to do. I had a person get upset with me because I wasn't going around a mail carrier truck fast enough, and they were screaming and honking at me all the way up the road. I could hear them, and I'm like, oh my gosh, you know, the old me would have gotten so upset, but I just blew it off. And it gets better when I got up the hill and I'm parked at the intersection and she's parked next to me. I went to roll down my window, just say, hey, I'm really sorry. I'm not sure what I did. And boom, she throws a water bottle at me. Yeah. And I'm just like the old me, and she's threatening me to get out and fight her. And I'm like, no, I'm really sorry. I'm sorry. I don't know what I did, but I'm really sorry, you know, if I made you late for work. And it's not funny, but it is, because I know the old me would have ended up getting beat up because I'm not in shape anymore like I used to be, and put in jail. But the new me was just like, first I had so much empathy, like, oh, I bet I made her late for work. That's really bad. And I was apologizing to her even as the water is going through my front seat. And then I went to work and told everyone, and I wasn't upset or anything. I mean, again, I felt bad for her because she was having a very bad day. I can't even tell you what a miracle that is. That is the promises coming true. And that's a perfect one right there. So, and I could give you example after example of example of those kinds of things.
Yeah. How phenomenal. I'm thinking, you know, wow, to be like physically assaulted essentially. Right. And still just be like super empathetic to her situation, you know, and just realize like, wow, like she's not okay. And me, getting out of this car and being confrontational is not going to make this better for either one of us. Yeah. And to be able to like almost, you know, laugh about it today, you know, at the time it was probably very intense, but like, you said, like to be today, to just be like, how hilarious or, you know, absurd of a situation is that in order for this, you know, talk about road rage. kind of deal. And know like, yep, my life, like there was a time and day when that would have gone down a whole lot differently. For sure. So has it changed, you know, has it changed anything with like how you show up as an employee or as an adult child or a partner or a friend? Have any of those like more intimate kind of circular or inner circle relationships changed any as well?
Oh, absolutely. I just celebrated 1 year at my job, which I absolutely love. And every other job I've had my entire career, you know, I've been in corporate America 30 years now. At the 1 year mark, I was already so bitter and upset about every stupid thing you can imagine. And yet at this job, I'm just so grateful every day. And the people there like me, they're happy when I come into the office. They're glad I'm still there. They, you know, bought me breakfast on my 1 year, not abstinent food, but that's okay. I took off the stuff that was white flour and ate the rest, you know, that was, and they understand that and they are okay with that. But it's just amazing that the career I have, I'm making more money than I ever used to. And not that money's important, but the fact that I never had the confidence to try and get a job like I have now. So now I'm finally living up to my potential. So that's, and I feel useful now. There's, you know, definitely a meaning to what I do there, and people appreciate it. And then with my boyfriend, we've been together 22 years. So, I used to just be really mean and awful. He's just been a saint to keep up with me. When he's 13 years older than me. So sometimes he doesn't understand technology things and things like that. And I used to be really impatient. And now I've really tried, every time I start to help him with something, I think, okay, now stop, because you know, it really upsets him when I get snarky about things. So think about it from his standpoint. He's had a stressful day, be nice and help him out and give back to him for all the years he put up with when you were being, you know, not so great. And that's really helped. I've got a long way to go, but I'm a lot more patient with him with things like that. And in terms of, you know, I think you mentioned, I can't remember the other things. Oh, you mentioned as an adult child. Oh, that was the other thing. I'll just say quickly. I am estranged from my two brothers, and my parents are both deceased. And that's okay, you know, that my brothers and I don't speak, because, you know, that's okay. But I have a niece that I was very, very close to, and we just did so many things together. And she, because she's really close, you know, with her dad and my brother, we also stopped speaking for a while. But then I ended up about a year ago sending her a message, and now we do message back and forth. And just recently was her birthday, and it was really great because I was able to send her a message saying, you know, my birthday present to you, I just want you to know, is that I do a living amends every single day, being the person that I wish I could have been for you when we were, you know, close. And I sent her the paragraph from the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous. I can't say that today. Alcoholics Anonymous, page 417, about acceptance, which is that thing about living life on life's terms. And I just said, I accept the relationship we have now. It'd be great if it could be like it was before, but I understand it can't. I'm just so grateful for what we have now. So that's, you know, her Aunt Chris finally living up to the aunt she probably always wanted. And it's okay now, because I can still, you know, hear about what's going on without having that close physical in-person relationship. We can just, you know, message back and forth until she's ready to meet in person again.
Yeah. I mean, it sounds like so much healing has happened. I mean, you know, I know it wasn't just, oh, the alcohol is gone and things are better. Oh, the food, yeah. I'm working on the food and now things are better. You've done some real work here. And I'm really curious to know, like, has this been all 12-step work? Like, as far as, have you worked the steps with a sponsor, that kind of thing? Or has there been some, like, you know, has there been like a therapist also? I'm like, how did you do the work? How did you get to where you are?
Yeah, it's, you know, I would say the first 2.5 years, so it was November 2018. So, you know, the first year and a half, things were just all about getting over not drinking anymore. And then once I finally, you know, let loose of that obsession with the alcohol, and I think it was really when the pandemic started, things really started to change, because, you know, it changed life for everyone. But as far as what I did is, you know, I worked, okay, and I don't recommend this for everyone, because you should get a sponsor and go through the steps that way. I never got like an actual sponsor. I just had different people in my life from the programs, either AA or FA, that I really, really respect. And I'd speak to them about them. And when I did, you know, fourth step work, I did that with a therapist, because I personally didn't feel comfortable telling someone who's not qualified as a therapist about some of the things. So that's how I did it. And I have done definitely some therapy with some really great people. There's one, just your typical talk therapy with someone, a great counselor, a great therapist. And then also some somatic experience body work, which I recommend for everyone. Look into that. I have a great person I found that's been amazing. And it was really once I started, it was two things. It was just being the first 18 months of sobriety, and was just being gratitude for everything, being grateful for every little thing I could think of. And then it was acceptance on that paragraph and on page 417 about acceptance. It's a story in the back of the big book. It's just everything. And I really started to learn about acceptance and bring it into my life and combine that with what I was learning in therapy, and everything just shifted. So that's when the miracle happened and everything started to change. And that, a lot of that was from FA too, I have to say.
Yeah. Amazing. You know, and, mm-hmm. and you're not alone in that, you know, that feeling of, hey, some of this work, like I believe in this work, and there's mm-hmm. some really neat tools that 12 step mm-hmm. provides, the 12 step programs provide. But certainly I've worked with my clients through some of that step work, you know, fourth and fifth step kind of stuff, ninth step kind of, absolutely. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes it is that comfort level of like, I have to be vulnerable for this. And if I don't feel like I can be completely vulnerable, I'm not going to be able to do the work to the yes. extent that I want to be able to do it. So I need to do it with a trusted other. And I think it's mm-hmm. just amazing that like you were willing to do that for yourself, you know, that mm-hmm. you thought outside of the box and you did and have continued to do what works for you. I just think that's really neat. And I highly recommend that for everybody, right? Like find your own path. Like there's no yeah. wrong way, or there's no right. Maybe there are wrong ways to recover. Let me rephrase that, but there is no one yeah. right way to do this, right? Like what works for you is what works for you. So I'm really curious to know, what do you do for yourself every day, whether it be like in relation to, you know, how you stay sober from alcohol and recovery from alcohol use disorder, or the food, like what kinds of things do you do for yourself each day that like are just super important that they happen in order for you to stay like kind of in that recovery mindset?
I definitely implement gratitude into my day all day long. And that is, I think, one of the biggest things. Just as I go through my day, I just think about all the things I have and the way my life is. That's just amazing. And that keeps me grounded big time. And the other part is just as things happen and I want to get upset, I think about that whole acceptance theme again. That's really, really important to me. I don't always do a big chunk of quiet time, like 30 minutes in the morning, but I would love to get to that point where I'm doing it religiously that way. But I do try to take moments here or there to really stop and think, especially if something's really stressful. And just that moment that I never used to take before, where I really stop and think, okay, what is that other person thinking? Why are they behaving this way? Or this situation, why is it bothering me? Let's think through this. What is really the issue? Because usually what's upsetting me has nothing to do with whatever it is I'm immediately upset about. So those are the, you know, gratitude, acceptance, and really taking things slowly and thinking about things before I act is what keeps me grounded and going.
Absolutely. Now, do you have any kind of, I understand like, right. It's hard sometimes mm-hmm. to like really build in or build that practice of like meditation or quiet time or any of those kinds mm-hmm. of things, but like, do you have any kind of like morning routines or evening routines that keep you safe and sane? Like, do you mm-hmm. open the kitchen at a certain time, close it at a certain time, or do you attend so many meetings, or whether they're 12 step or not, you know, like therapy or just like with a trusted other, are there things, mm-hmm. are there components that have to happen throughout the week even that keep mm-hmm. you like moving in the direction you want to be moving?
Yeah, definitely. I have a home group meeting in AA every Monday night. It's a women's meeting. And I go to that. The only time I miss it is if I'm sick or something, or if there's just something just I can't skip out on. But I try to arrange my schedule so there isn't anything scheduled for Monday nights. So that is important. And I always go to the fellowship afterwards, which means, you know, going out to eat, which isn't great for my food program, but because they know what I can and can't eat, they are really supportive about that. So it's just a great way to kind of start the work week. I mean, it's kind of at the end of Monday because it's in the evening. So that's one thing throughout the week. And then the other thing that I do, almost every night, unless it's out there raining, is I go outside and I usually have it. Well, I always have at least my dog here, but I dog sit. So, and I dog sit in my home. So I always have other dogs, and I just like to sit out on my patio and watch the dogs run around. I try to do that for at least 15 minutes, if not 30 minutes. I do that almost every evening. And I've read, I don't know if this is really helps or not, but I've read about grounding where you put your, you know, you have your bare feet touching the ground, and it's could be just psychosomatic, but I love it. I just feel like connected. I don't know what I'm going to do when it gets colder, because I just started doing this recently, but that is something I do every night. And I feel it just really gets me in a good position than to spend the rest of the evening doing something helpful and good, not just watching TV or streaming. Those are the main things that I do kind of on a schedule routine.
Yeah, it's lovely. It's just interesting, like how these things mm-hmm. we start to incorporate. And I think the thing, like the nugget that I love that you mm-hmm. said is you prioritize that homemaking mm-hmm. on Monday nights yeah. and you do your best to make sure, right? Like that's priority. And you only mm-hmm. miss if for whatever reason, there is something that you literally can't get out of. And that's the mm-hmm. only reason. And that's, you know, I think that's hard to start to wrap our brains around, because for so long we've prioritized everybody else over ourselves. Mm-hmm. And so it can, you know, feel quote unquote selfish to show mm-hmm. up and say like, oh no, I've got a pass, or no, sorry, I can't volunteer that night, or I can't mm-hmm. work. I can't, whatever. I've got this other thing, but really it's important. It's like your anchor for the week. Like you yeah. said, it's a great way to start off your week. Even if it is at the end of a Monday, mm-hmm. it's a really nice anchor to your work week. And like, it's something you look forward to. And then, like you said, you go out for this fellowship afterward mm-hmm. and it's about that connection piece as mm-hmm. well. Right. All of that. And I just think that's super lovely. I think grounding, I think that's real. You know, I think that we have yeah. research that actually shows that that's real is connecting. I mean, the earth has vibration, you know, mm-hmm. and we have vibration, right? There's energy. And again, it's about that connecting piece. And I imagine it feels pretty spiritual in order to, you know, mm-hmm. to be out there with the dogs and just kind of watching them yeah. have their playtime. And then you've got your bare feet in the grass and you're connecting, you know, and I just think that's really neat too, that you do find the time to do that every night. And yes, it's going to be getting colder. So maybe there's, you know, some sort of alternative that you might yeah. have to figure out, but in the meantime, it works. So you keep doing it. Yeah.
I think I've literally figured out what I'm probably going to do is we have an electric blanket and I'm going to run the electric cord or whatever through the doggy door inside into the outlet. So I can just wrap up in the blanket and put it on my feet too.
Oh, that's such a good idea. I love it. You must not be in a place that gets snow.
Well, we do, not a lot. I'm in St. Louis. So, okay. Yeah, now when we get snow, I'll be out there, but I won't be barefoot.
Okay.
That'll be too cold, but yeah. But we don't get that much. So.
Okay. Okay. So it stays pretty mild throughout the winter.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's perfect. Well, good. Okay. So then you can do that kind of thing. Yeah. That's neat. All right. Well, I'm also wondering, you know, what do you need to hear when you were first starting these mm-hmm. journeys, you know, whether it be with the alcohol or the food, both mm-hmm. any sort of recovery kind of work, like if you could talk to somebody who was just starting out, like mm-hmm. what would you love to be able to say to them? What's something you wish somebody would have said to you?
I would say, do not be afraid to ask for help, because a lot of people say, oh, you need help. And they say it in a negative way. And I'm like, no, you deserve help. Just like if you had a physical thing wrong with some part of your body, you would deserve to be able to go to the doctor and get help. And you do with this as well. You, whatever it takes to get you well, you deserve that. And if it doesn't make sense at first and you think it's completely stupid, just keep coming back because it's going to happen in your time. Just like with me, it took me, you know, 12, 13 years. I wish it would have been faster, but it happened the way it was supposed to happen. So be kind to yourself while it's working and just keep coming back. Even if you're still drinking or you're still binging or whatever, keep coming to meetings, keep talking to people that are in the program. Even if it's been a year since you've been to one, just pop in every once in a while, because eventually it's going to click. That's what happened for me.
Absolutely. Oh, that's such a great message. Like, just keep coming back. Eventually it's going to click. Yes. Mm-hmm. Right. You never know which time, yeah. right? Like,
yeah,
you know, right. You just never know which time it's going to stick.
Yeah, right? That's so true. I mean, yeah. Who, you know, I never thought it, you know, I'd be one who made it. I'll have 4 years on the 15th, and no way I ever thought that was going to happen. I'm like, you know, something will get messed up, but yeah, I kept coming back for those 12 or 13 years. And then it finally clicked. So yeah. It's amazing.
Right. And I mean, and I think you pretty much alluded to the last 4 years, like you can't imagine, you know, going back to, right. Like it's so night and day, right. It's like, how did I not do that sooner? Right. And I think we right. We all get that where it's like, oh, like, how did I not know that if I would, but that's part of the problem, right? Like nobody can explain what it's like on the other side of that wall, right? When we're up against it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's like, if, you know, if you break your arm, you know, that if you go get it set and you keep it and you do what the doctor says, we all know it's going to feel a lot better. We know that. We don't have, you know, we don't have to question that, but this is so abstract. There's no way you can know, well, if I put all this work in, it's not going to work. Well, because there's no way for you to know, because it's so abstract. And just keep trying, just keep coming back, because it will eventually click and you'll get it. And then you'll be like, oh, I get it now. Yeah. And then you'll want to help others do the same thing. And that's when it really gets cool.
Absolutely. Right. Mm-hmm. That whole pay it forward or wanting to share like whatever it is, like to bottle it, you know, and give it to people. I think, you know, nobody would need it after a while, right? Because just everybody would be getting what they need. And so, yeah, it's on us to just keep showing up and, you know, paying it forward or doing, you know, right, that service work aspect of it.
Oh, yeah.
Whether it's being a sponsor ourselves or whatever kind of service work it is. It doesn't even have to be, again, it doesn't have to be 12-step related, folks, but just like that giving it away in order to keep it concept is so real.
Yeah, that's, well, the past year I met someone online, and you know, I always look, when I go to online meetings, I always look for who has a dog or whatever. And there was someone who had one dog, and then it looked like another dog, but maybe the same dog. And then again, with a third dog and then a fourth dog, I'm like, what's going on? And I messaged her. She's like, oh, I have four Dalmatians. So that's why they kind of looked alike, but they weren't. And she's like, I'm 42 hours sober. I'm freaking out. I don't know what to do. And so I was her sober buddy. And for a year, she got her year in August. And the last year of my life has been awesome because of helping her. And we're good friends now. And she's actually in a different state, but we met twice because she's from Missouri originally and comes back to visit family. And helping her through that, it was just amazing. I can't even explain the joy that brings, you know, helping someone.
And I just think about all the people that will get to the opportunity to see this, your story, see this video, you know, and in turn, like you're just helping that many more people and they're going to connect to this story. I mean, it's just so relatable. And I think that even if everything that you've been through or everything you're saying doesn't land 100% for anybody, there are many piece parts of this that I know for sure me, you know, I'm just like, yes, yes, that's awesome. And I just so appreciate your willingness to reach out and let me record answering my questions and being willing to just, you know, increase awareness and decrease stigma around, you know, food addiction in general, you know, addiction in general for sure. But, you know, really speaking to the food addiction piece of it and to know you're not alone. And for so many of us, it does start with another substance, or maybe it started with food, but we didn't know it was food. And then it turned into some other substance. We get rid of the other substances or process addiction, whatever it might be. And then we're left with the food and we're like, oh gosh, I'm doing the same thing with the food that I was doing with the X, Y, or Z. Yeah.
Well, and for me, I just have to say really quickly, I do really feel that the food addiction, the sugar addiction was completely intertwined with the alcohol addiction. Cause my drug of choice was wine. And I didn't like any of the other stuff at all. Like to this day, I don't even crave it at all. So yes, please pay attention to your food addiction. It is a very real thing. And it's just as dangerous as an addiction to alcohol, because type 2 diabetes and all the health things that go along with it, plus just the obsession in your mind and the emotional energy it's taking from you it's deadly in the end.
Oh, I couldn't agree more. Well, thank you again, Chris, so much for your time. I completely appreciate it. And I hope to get to hear more of your story in the future.
Okay. Thank you so much.
If you like what you heard today, please remember to like, comment, share, and subscribe. Thank you for watching.